Hey, it's Addy D. In this video, we'll be doing some harmonic analysis of the Elliott Smith song, Coming Up Roses. I've been wanting to do an Elliott Smith song for a while, and honestly, I could have had myself a good time analyzing any number of his songs. The reason I chose this one is that it kind of condenses a lot of the tricks that make his songwriting so singular into a neat little display that's easy to pick apart. Stuff like chromatic voice leading and mode borrowing would show up everywhere in his music. So yeah, I'm just going to nerd out on this song for hopefully less than 10 minutes, and you're free to join.
This is off the 1995 self-titled album.
So this introduction, featuring the chords of the yet-to-be-revealed chorus, has already taken us a lot of places. The melody has this effect of sinking, searching for a resolution. A safe place to rest. And it's taking forever. The chords used dance back and forth between the key centers of F, which I'll put in yellow, and A flat, orange, giving it that unsure sense of where it all has to end up, because they both kind of sound like a good place to build a home. We could easily take the yellow root and resolve an F, that's totally fine. Or will we keep on that orange track towards a slightly darker A flat key? But this minor third key relationship is far from arbitrary. In fact, it's very common in popular music, Elliott Smith's included. To understand better, first let's distinguish between relative minor and parallel minor. Now, every major scale has a relative minor scale embedded in it if you start a third lower. No notes are changed, but the tonal emphasis has shifted to minor. So F major becomes D minor, and A flat major becomes F minor. And these are the relative minors. That's where parallel minor comes in. Parallel minor is the minor scale that's built on the same tonic of the major key we were just in, F in this case. And since F minor is the relative minor of A flat, having the same key signature of four flats, it's common terminology to say that we're borrowing from the parallel minor to get these darker chords, even if an actual F minor chord has yet to show its face. This is mode borrowing, mixing sounds of the major and minor modes of the same root, F, into one piece of music that sort of lives in between. It's a great place to borrow darker sounds when in major. Also this one. Can't forget the minor four. Or brighter sounds when in minor. It's all about keeping things interesting. But usually it leans one way or the other. Seeing that this is all we have to go with so far, the balance is about equal. Now the dance between F and A flat has to end somewhere. And it does end up in favor of the A-flat tonality, the relative major of F minor, as we get into the rest of the chorus. Then the verse unravels with the most typical Elliott Smith progression of all time, the 1, major 2, 4 trope. Elliott Smith's compositional style is contrapuntal and features smooth, often chromatic, voice leading, thinking of every note in the chord as a voice in the choir and being sympathetic to where it wants to go next. Check out these examples and listen for the harmonies rising or falling in tiny movements into the next chord. This voice movement, falling from the 5,
chromatically down to the third, is canon in classical, folk, and popular music. More traditionally, the two would be treated as a secondary dominant, or the five of five, basically the momentary shifting of key center to tonicize a chord that isn't the one chord, giving it the same pull and importance of the one by crafting its own five, a wormhole to another tonal dimension, sort of. Look up secondary dominant, you'll find better explanations online. But it's been substituted here for a four chord, giving a mellower sound that he favors while keeping the descending chromatic line. The 1, major 2, 4, or some variation of it, is used in probably 85% of Elliott Smith's songs, but what's a little weird here is that the 3 chords, holding for 1 bar each, cycle and loop over an 8 bar phrase, resulting in an irregular harmonic motion, a phasing effect. It's a clever trick that gives the illusion more is going on than really is. In the pre-chorus, we get the first introduction of an actual F minor chord, and we also get a C major chord, which we'll soon see is our gateway back to F major in the chorus. In the chorus, the first bar of F is shortened to a 2-4, so these 3 sections, verse, pre-chorus, and chorus, repeat in that order, except there's no second verse, just a guitar solo over the same chord changes, which serves as the song's middle 8. It has the effect of being a new section, but it's another clever illusion that gets its power from its simplicity. And then we go into the pre-chorus with new lyrics this time around, and straight into the second chorus. At this point, the song is wrapping up already, and Elliott wanted to be able to repeat the chorus a few times for a playout. I mean, what's a pop song if you don't repeat the chorus at least twice at the end, right? Now, this is a chorus that, as we know, starts in F major and ends decisively in A flat, so we had to do a little rewiring of the progression to create the desired circuit. Which brings us back to the 5 chord. 5 chords are like buses that take you most places you want to go. If you want to go somewhere close, it's pretty seamless. But if you want to go a little further, you might have to go out of your way to catch the bus. And the bus might look a little funny, because it's from a weird town 100 miles away. And sometimes the same bus can take you to the dark side of town. The chorus of Coming Up Roses ends in a 5 chord for the last 2 beats, that has up till now been an E flat chord, a pleasantly smooth bus ride to A flat. But he needs a bus that will take him to F, which is luckily not too far out of the way. Maybe the bus just had to pass through a tunnel, but not too bad of a ride overall. That bus comes in the form of a C chord, replacing the E flat at the end of the chorus to be the 5 of F, which is the same way we got there from the pre-chorus, so it's a little bit of cutting and pasting. Perspective, here's the chorus going back into itself without the rewiring, just chopped and pasted. This could work, and I wouldn't rule it out as an option, it's just a little bold, a taste thing really. So the last bar of the chorus, it's a bit like a choose your own adventure story. Will you stay on the orange bus and go back to the verse? Or jump on the yellow bus in the last 2 beats and go to the chorus. So, there you go. These are just a few things I thought were cool about this song, and many of these tricks show up in the rest of Smith's catalog, and in lots of other music, of course, too. So try to look out for the chromatic voice leading in the counterpoint, and mode borrowing in chord progressions. It's beautiful stuff. Hope that was fun. Have a nice day.